hearts and minds of our children. Dr. Carol Swain is a widely recognized expert on campaign and elections, racial politics, immigration reform, and religious liberty. Professor Swain has served on the Tennessee Advisory Committee to the U.S. Civil Rights Commission and the National Endowment for the Humanities Council. Her opinion pieces have been published in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and various other publications. She has also been a regular contributor to various media outlets. Before joining Vanderbilt, Professor Swain was a tenured associate professor of politics and public policy at Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. Dr. Swain has also produced two viral Prager University videos. Before Dr. Swain takes the stage, we are going to watch a brief 6-minute documentary about her life.
We were the poorest of the poor, and that was a part of the identity. I'm a university professor now, but I never can remember a time growing up that I ever said, I want to be a university professor. I was born and raised in the rural South, and I was one of 12 children. I was second from the oldest. We lived in extreme poverty. The early part of my life, we lived in a two-room shack, and it was literally a shack. It's so tiny. And my elder sister and I and some of the younger, the children that were the first kids, we slept on the kitchen floor. The house did not have any running water or indoor plumbing, and not having a bathroom in the house, and so really having what the older people call a slop jar in the house and having to empty that. Those are things that made it very difficult. You had to put a pot on the stove and heat up the water to bathe in. And all of us bathed from that same cruddy pail of water. And you know, you can imagine by the time it got to the third or fourth kid, it's pretty dirty. And it was not uncommon for us to go into the local dumps looking for whatever we could find. Growing up in that shack, all I can remember is just sadness. It was very depressed. I always felt unloved. There was always conflict in the house. There was never enough of anything. There were fights every Friday when my stepfather got paid. There would be a fight between my mother and the stepfather, but these would be really violent fights. The most graphic memory is my stepfather chasing my mother with an axe, threatening to kill her, and the children, we were running around, you know, grabbing at his legs, trying to protect our mother. Later, my mother moved to the city when I was probably 12 or 13 and became involved with social workers and welfare programs. And what I watched happen in my family was that it became a way of life for her and for some of my siblings. And I saw what a trap welfare is, and for many people, and still for some of my siblings, they've never held a steady job. At that time, I was a high school dropout. I had dropped out after completing the eighth grade. I felt shame, I felt fear, I was depressed. And so I married at 16, not because I was in love. I married a neighbor that was a little bit older, just to get away from home. Part of the misery that I experienced in my childhood, some of it just continued into my marriage and into my early life. At some point, I started taking bottles of pills and I really wanted to die. I had the experience of being in the hospital after one of my suicide gestures, having a medical doctor tell me that I was intelligent, that I was attractive, and that kind of shocked me because I was, you know, at least 20, 21, and I'd never heard anyone tell me that I was attractive. He said, you're intelligent, you're attractive, you can do more with your life. I took a job outside the home, I filed for divorce. Everything started to change, and at one of the nursing homes where I was working as a nurse's aide, I met an African orderly from Sierra Leone. He said, you ought to go to college. And those words changed my life. I studied hard. I earned my GED. I worked hard doing whatever I could do to get by, and I was able to graduate from a community college, go on to a four-year college, and graduate magna cum laude, and I went on to earn several graduate degrees. Somehow, I always believed that I could do it, that I could better myself, that I was not meant to be poor. I was able to far exceed anything that I imagined for myself or anyone else probably that was watching my life unfold. These milestones, my accomplishments, didn't come easy. It was through hard work, it was perseverance, a can-do spirit that I attribute to the grace of God. It is so amazing what a little encouragement and direction can do. But the system itself doesn't encourage people to better themselves. The social welfare programs that we have in America puts a band-aid on the problem, but it does not fix it. The only thing these programs do is create, in the long term, a sense of entitlement that results in a loss of self-worth for the individual. The truth is, people feel good about themselves when they can work and provide for themselves and for their families.
Thank you so much. I get my energy from young people. And there's nowhere else I would rather be this morning than speaking to you all, because I have so much faith and confidence in you. I believe that you are the ones that are going to change America. As a college professor, the universities always tell the incoming class that they're the best and the brightest. We lie sometimes. But in this room, we do have the best and the brightest because you survived the indoctrination system. Whether you went to a private school, a public school, or you were homeschooled, there are so many forces that would try to indoctrinate you and push you to the political left. And so you are the survivors. And you're not the ones I'm writing about in this book, Abduction: How Liberalism Steals the Hearts and Minds of Our Children, because you in this room have not been abducted. You have your hearts and your minds, and you're in the right place today. You are in the right place this week. And I know that some of you all may have made sacrifices to get here. I don't know, you know, what your parents, everyone's not rich just because you're white, mostly white in this room doesn't mean you're rich, right? Some of you made sacrifices to get here. And hopefully you are equipped for the school year and for the rest of your lives. So with that, I want to briefly say that the story of my life is a God story, that I am a devout Christian. I wasn't always so. I became devout about 18 years ago. And this was after I had been a professor at Princeton and had been tenured. So I was a late comer to faith. Those of you who are not, who already know God and who are not late comers to faith, you have an advantage. And I realize that everyone in this room is not a Christian. Some of you come from various faiths. Some of you may even be atheists. But hopefully those atheists would not leave here that way, or spend the rest of your lives wondering if there is a God that knows you, that loves you, that set you apart in your mother's womb. So with that, I'm going to use prepared notes because I don't want to miss the things that I think will be important for you all for the next school year. And I believe if I use the notes, we will have time for questions. and answers. So, my notes. I've already said it's great to be here. I know that you all care about America, and you care about what's happening. And our nation is at a crossroads. We watch together the moral, economic, and religious decline of a nation that was once, you know, the envy of the entire world. We see that respect for science, history, and facts are taking a back seat to feelings and emotions. First Amendment rights, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of association can no longer be taken for granted in America. Nor can conservative Christians, Jews, and others that practice religions according to their consciences. They can no longer take that freedom for granted without the interference of an overbearing, overreaching federal and sometimes state and local government. We have judges, as you know, who are activists. They write opinions and they render decisions that impact the most sacred areas of our lives. Our nation is no longer free, and we have powerful corporations like Facebook and Google who are using their profits to work against the public interest. Ronald Reagan warned us many years ago, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same, or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in the United States where men were free. And we are rapidly reaching that point for people my age, and so I shudder to think what it would be like for you as you raise your families unless you rise up now and fight. We can no longer take our freedoms for granted. Our freedoms are being snatched away. Whether we like it or not, our tax dollars subsidize the murder of the unborn. Our educational system is a wreck. Our colleges and universities are no longer marketplaces of ideas. We're using our resources, your parents, your wealth, your grandparents. We support institutions that show no respect for traditional values or the rights of other people. In fact, these institutions seek to indoctrinate you, our children, with a deadly form of progressivism that is unhealthy for you and for our nation. This is the reality of contemporary America. We have forgotten who we are as a people. Consequently, it is far more difficult to learn from the past and the wisdom of our forefathers. And yes, I said our forefathers, my forefathers, your forefathers. Repeatedly, we have tolerated and reelected leaders who have no love for America or no love for its people of any race or creed. We see bad decisions in how we handle legal and illegal immigration. We see bad decisions in our failure to enforce the rule of law. We see it in our inability to get beyond racial tensions and unrest. We see bad decisions in the creation and maintenance of a welfare system that entraps people into generational poverty. We see it in our decision to turn our military into a laboratory for social engineering rather than a lean, mean fighting machine. Now, I could go on and on about the national debt, the nearly bankrupt Social Security system that you all probably will not get any of. Hopefully, I'll live long enough to get all of mine. And in the infiltration and corruption found in the U.S. intelligence agencies and in the halls of government. How did this happen? Well, I would say we the people have surrendered our authority, in some cases our common sense, to corrupt and immoral leaders who work contrary to the interests of the people. As we can see from the constant barrage of attacks and the efforts to destroy and undermine President Trump, it would take more than a new president and a Republican Congress to turn things around. It would take you, the best and brightest from this generation, to stand up and say, no more. This is too soft. No more. Thank you. Our problems are not political, they are spiritual. We have abandoned our Judeo-Christian roots. Within the Republican Party, we have people who have adopted the failed socialist agenda of the Democrats. Rather than stand by the solid principles of the national GOP platform that affirms God, family, and country. Too many of our leaders are weak and ineffectual. We see widespread hypocrisy and deception, a disregard for human life at any stage of development, an abandonment of traditional family, rising divorce rates, and a reluctance to enforce the rule of law and ethical standards of behavior. If we were enforcing ethical standards of behavior, you would not have all the leaks and all the efforts to destroy a president that was elected by the people. We are reluctant to speak honestly about race, radical Islam, and the aggressive LGBTIAZONPZ agenda that takes no prisoners. Many of us have been ill-equipped to fight against the radicalism of the disciples of Saul Alinsky, Herbert Marcuse, and Antonio Gramsci. If you don't know who they are, you better learn their names. They need to become your best friends over the next few years. Saul Alinsky advocated deception, manipulation, and infiltration of institutions and organizations. Alinsky was a Marxist who advised the protesters of the 1960s to take a bath, cut their hair, and to go into institutions and destroy them from within. And what we see today is a takeover of the government, of our institutions, and of our churches from people who went in as our friends to destroy those institutions from within. We now reap the fruits of Saul Alinsky's labor. But don't despair. We can use his advice. So one of my charges to each of you is to read Saul Alinsky's Rules for Radicals. We use his advice to reclaim our institutions. Now I'm going to get churchy on you. Daniel 11:32 tells us, those who know their God will be strong and carry out great exploits. And so those of you who know God will do things that no one would think was possible because you're not doing it in your own strength. And those who know anything about biblical history knows that God does not call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And that means if you have a dream in your heart, if there's something that you believe you're supposed to do, and someone's telling you that you're not smart enough, you're not pretty enough, you're not well connected enough, that's a lie from the pit of hell. You can do all things. We must rise up and confront those who would strip us of our weapons. 2 Corinthians 10:4 tells us the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. So we're not doing this in our own strength. We can rise up and confront the bullies who are attempting to silence us and to pervert truth about sexuality, science, and the threat of Islam. We must not allow the left's skill at hurling epithets silence our voices. We must fight for our Constitution and for our way of life. Thank you. We have every reason to resist and reclaim the mission that universities once had for being marketplaces of ideas. Political correctness, all of this nonsense about microaggressions and the trigger warnings and all of that stuff, it's destructive. Political correctness impedes the ability of every student to get an adequate education. Education itself comes from being exposed to engaging with, and wrestling with ideas that is not happening on most college and university campuses. Political correctness forces people to engage in strategic behavior and subterfuge, and I'm not against that for you all. You have to sort of look at your environment and map out a strategy. And so it'll be different from every person at every institution. So you do have to be strategic, but you're being forced into it. And so in a couple of weeks, you all will go to university campuses where you will have to go through the orientation. And so you're set there and you hear all this nonsense that's based on feely, touchy nonsense. And it'll be totally devoid of common sense. And in those situations, it's probably best not to rise up and challenge it at that time. You take copious notes, and then you email them to the campus reform or some organization that's monitoring what takes place on university campuses. And you also use them to your own advantage. And universities claim to believe in diversity, inclusion, and free speech. Well, Saul Alinsky's rules for radicals, one of the rules is to make your enemy live up to his rule book. And so you take the information. Sometimes you speak and sometimes you keep your mouth shut. If you're like me, you're wired to speak, and so some of you all will not be able to keep your mouth shut. For those of you all, I will be your support group. There are people that will stand behind you. But for some of us, not me and not you that are bold, but for some people, it's better to keep your mouth shut sometimes and to be strategic and gather the information. We need people who can infiltrate, and that means some of you all need to join the campus Democrats. Some of you all need to go into the environmentalist groups. Some of you all need to go into those groups, especially those that have the all-commons policies. Go in there, take leadership positions, and take them over. Political correctness creates stress, it dumbs down the educational process, and it tells you all what to think rather than how to think. It's destructive and it impedes the development of critical thinking. Political correctness forces conformity by using shaming tactics, it denies science, and it revises and destroys history. Another of the Saul Alinsky rules has to do with ridicule. He says ridicule is man's most potent weapon. The political left is very adept at using ridicule. Whenever we get close to the truth, they call us conspiracy theorists. Conspiracy theorists, that's thrown at people to silence them and to push them away when they're getting too close to the truth. When we call them snowflakes, then we are using their own tactic against them. And some of you all who are very creative can come up with other descriptors to go along with snowflakes, but we're doing pretty well on our side, and so keep it up. Okay, fighting back requires courage, a willingness to stand alone and to persuade others, because hopefully, if you're called to leadership, you may have to take a stance, and you may have to stand alone. But you should be able to persuade others to see your vision. And for those of you all who are called to leadership, you know, when you go to that orientation session in the next couple of weeks, you know, maybe you're not called to be quiet like I think most of you all are. You know, maybe there is someone that's going to stand up. But if you stand up, make sure you have your facts and make sure you do it in a respectful way. We're not going to adopt all the tactics of the political left. We're not going to shut down other people's free speech, but we're going to try to engage them in a conversation. And they're afraid of facts, they're afraid of history, and they're afraid of science. They are science deniers. And so you engage them with facts. And a leader must be willing to bear the consequences of failure. The 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence were willing to risk their lives, their fortunes, and their honor to establish a nation. What about you? What about you all in this room? What are you willing to risk? Are you willing to risk a B instead of an A? What are your limits? For those of us who believe in the Judeo-Christian God, we don't fight alone. We have our security. Our security does not come from man. It comes from our knowledge of who we are and what we believe about what we are called to do. And so this, you know, is the last day of what's been a great conference. You all need to go back and to do whatever it is that you're called to do. And we're all on a journey. No one's journey looks the same. No one should judge anyone else when they tell them that they believe God has called them, you know, to be the next president or whatever it is that you feel like you're called to do. You're called to make films. You know, you're called to do something that maybe no one in your family agrees with it. They think you're not hearing from God. You're the only one that needs to hear from God. And so whatever you have in your heart, you need to trust it. And you also need to know that a lot of things that at your age that you get glimpses of, and I firmly believe we get a glimpse of our future, it's not for now. It has taken me 63 years to be who I am today. And one of the things I had to overcome was shyness. And I had this shyness even as a professor. I was so shy that if people asked me my name, I would freeze and I would forget it. Literally. And I would write out everything I was going to say in class because I wanted to get those participation points. And I would read it and my voice would be quivering. And I had to overcome shyness to be able to do media and to be able to do the things that I'm doing today. And it would never have occurred to me that I would be doing what I'm doing today. And a lot of things that you think you're going to do, you know, maybe, you know, you all want to go to law school. Hopefully not. Because we have enough lawyers. And so in this room, there are some brilliant people. And a lot of you are thinking of law school. And I want to challenge and encourage more of you to go into academia, even if it means being strategic and keeping your mouth shut. And I don't really endorse deception, but if you know the arguments of the other side and you know truth, you should be able to articulate strong and persuasive positions in papers, in articles, in books that will get you the kind of attention that you need to be successful, to be able to penetrate the faculties of America's best universities. And the students, how you can help make a space for conservative faculty, you can do that by, again, going to the universities, looking at their mission statements and all those lies they put in the recruitment literature, and holding them, making them live up to their rule book. They say they believe in diversity. They say they believe in inclusion. They believe in free speech. Well, they should believe in ideological diversity. And so you need to start organizing and pressing for ideological diversity. And then you can help pave the way for those token conservatives that are not even on the faculty now. And so, I mean, that's your charge. Everyone doesn't belong in law school. Some of you belong in academia. Some of you belong in those corporations that have been taken over by the political left. Keep your head down low. When you get inside, hire people just like you. And when you get a critical mass, you take over the institutions. Thank you. Okay, I take questions now. And before I take my first question, I would like to acknowledge Matt Colleran. He was the head of YAF at Vanderbilt, and he just graduated. And he often stood alone fighting the good fight.
Good afternoon, Dr. Swain. My name is Victor Santos. I'm an incoming sophomore at the University of Florida. And my question for you is this. I have a very good friend who is black, and he just got accepted into Vanderbilt University. His name is Jaden. Maybe you'll meet him. And he still believes that the policies instituted from the inception of the Jim Crow laws have caused the black population to be the way they are today, and that they still need to be on welfare in order to have that push to get him out into the world. And I just wanted to ask, what can I tell him to understand the truth that you and I both know?
Well, thank you for your question. And effective August 15th, I will no longer be on the faculty at Vanderbilt. And no, they did not run me off the campus. I decided that I wanted a larger classroom, that I would rather spend my time writing and doing public speaking and helping raise up the next generation of leaders. And so it was a free choice. But I am involved with conservatives on campus. It sounds like your friend Jaden will not be. I think that in the black community, so many people have been just literally brainwashed by the Democrats, and the Democrats strike terror in so many hearts. I can remember just about before every renewal of the Voting Rights Act, this rumor would get out that the Republicans were going to take away people's right to vote. The right to vote is a fundamental right. It's not taken away that easily. And for those that claim that slavery was responsible for the condition of black America, if you look at the generations that emerged from slavery, even up to the 1950s and part of the 1960s, blacks were in stable two-parent families. And that began to break down because of some of the welfare policies and programs. For example, the aid to families with dependent children that had a policy, no man in the house. And so all of a sudden, you know, women did not have, they had to get rid of the man to be able to get any kind of assistance from government. And around the early 1970s, Richard Nixon had a policy, he was trying to help the black community, and not just blacks, but poor people in the South, by guaranteeing every family $4,000 a year as a just a blanket grant, block grant, or block grant is not the appropriate term, but they were going to guarantee every family. The Congressional Black Caucus fought against it because it came from Republicans, but that would have kept the black families intact. When Moynihan wrote his thesis about the dysfunction in the black community in the 1960s, only 25% of black households were female-headed. Now it's probably 70%. And so if you look at history, the history does not support the narrative that the problems in the black community all came from Jim Crow. In fact, if you go to the New England schools, colleges and universities that did not discriminate have always had black alumni. There were blacks getting into Harvard. There were blacks getting into Yale. It took them longer to get into Princeton for Jews, too, because they did discriminate. But your friend is misguided, and I'm afraid that he and the other young blacks that are going to college campuses, many of them will take courses just in black studies, and they would just get indoctrinated with more and more stuff that would turn them bitter towards their friends, and it's false, and it keeps them captive. And so if you can expose people to ideas, if you can find articles or people that he would view as credible, you know, maybe some of the writings of some of the black conservatives or some of the liberals who have become enlightened, I would share those with my friend and just pray and hope for the best.
Thank you very much.
My name is Patrick Doyle from the University of Texas at Austin, and my question for you is, you mentioned in your speech and in your answers that it's very important for people to derive the truth and find it. So do you believe that it is uniquely dangerous for conservatives to attend ideologically homogenous universities that are also conservative if it is bad for the left to do it as well?
Are you talking about Hillsdale? Because we know you're not... Because we know you're not talking about the Christian colleges. They have already been infiltrated. So they're not homogenous. I think that wherever you go, that you need to engage ideas. And so I've already said that every student here needs to know Saul Alinsky. You need to read Radicals, Rules for Radicals. You need to know Herbert Marcuse. You need to know what Antonio Gramsci advocated and how political correctness and this whole cultural Marxism, their agendas. And so I think that wherever you go, you need to be exposed to those ideas. And then you need to develop what you think. And I believe that libertarianism, and I know a lot of you all are calling yourselves libertarians, that's a cop-out for people who... And so, you know, the worst thing you can do is go to a university, or even if you are going to a private school, and I think we're not doing our young people, we're not doing well by them sometimes when we don't expose them to the ideas that they're going to encounter as soon as they leave home. And so young people need worldview training. If you're Christian, you need apologetics, and you need it by the time you get to middle school.
Hi, thank you for coming out. My name is Cole Fisher, and I go to Saddleback College. My question is kind of going off the first question that was asked about like how people talk about how Jim Crow laws and stuff like that have kept the black community down. How do we get people that are living in poverty-stricken areas that are relying on the welfare state, how do we start to inspire them to go out and get jobs to support their family rather than relying on the welfare state?
Well, I can tell you that whatever we've been doing for the last 50 years, it hasn't worked. And in many ways, you know, poverty, the hopelessness, the strategies of the political left are failing people. I think that we need to make sure that we do have hearts of compassion, because there's a lot of crime in many of the inner city areas and even in some rural neighborhoods, but there are people there, you know, of goodwill and good hearts, people that, you know, need a hand up and not a handout. And when we look at programs like affirmative action, which is in the news now, I've always felt that affirmative action needed to be means tested and race blind, because there are a lot of poor whites, and we see, you know, what's happening in parts of Appalachia and just parts of the country, and the white mortality rate is rising. And it's not getting the kind of attention you think it would be getting across the country, because I think if it were any other group except white people, it would be the subject of so much news and it would be talked about on university campuses, but it's not really being talked about. I think that if you want to help people in the inner city, if you're Christian, I always say proceed everything with prayer, but you know, if you don't know what to do, then just reach out and help one person. I would argue that the people who changed my life were the medical doctor who told me I was intelligent, I was attractive, I could do more with my life, and the orderly from Sierra Leone that said, you ought to go to college. And up until then, I thought you had to be rich to go to college. I didn't know about scholarships and opportunities. And so, you know, like if you don't know what to do, then work on that one person that you may meet at a restaurant. You may, they may be, you know, carrying newspapers or throwing newspapers, whatever you call it. Whatever they're doing, you know, just work on one person at a time. If everyone does that, you create a ripple effect. And, you know, don't assume that you know, all minorities hate you. Some do, but not all. And invite people, you know, to events. Invite them to your churches. And I am a caretaker. I have my mother. She lives with me. And my caregivers are African American, and they go to church with us. And they're just shocked at how people are so loving towards them. And there's one that goes to the Sunday school class, and she's being treated like a member of the church, and she did not have exposure to white people until then. And so a lot of it is that we're not having the kind of conversations that we need to have, or the interactions that humanize each other. So.
Thank you.
Good morning, Dr. Swan. My name is Caroline Lindy. I'm a rising freshman at Hillsdale College, and I agree with you that reading Rules for Radicals and John Dewey is going to help strengthen my fight. But
and also read Orwell's 1984, yes. And there's yes. Huxley's Brave New World.
Mm-hmm. But as someone who, as a young Asian American female who has dealt with institutionalized racism and racism in general, my question to you is, how do you use your past experiences, but not play into identity politics?
I have an identity, and it's in Christ. Amen. And the other part of it is if we see other people and see their humanity, then we can love them and we can be kind to them even when they're being rude to us. Mm-hmm. And that will melt some of the opposition. But you need to know who you are and stand for what you believe you're called to do.
Thank you so very much, ma'am.
Okay.
Hello, thank you for coming. First of all, I loved your PragerU videos. They were great.
Thank you.
And so my question is, so I grew up around Philadelphia, and I go to school near Bridgeport, Connecticut. So I don't know what it's like to live in a lot of those places, but I've seen a lot of them. And from the means by which you grew up, my question for you is, should, in order to reform those areas, should we take the approach of improving economic opportunity or improving the culture?
Well, I don't know how you improve the culture. I think that a lot of the responsibility lies on other black people like me. And I speak sometimes at inner city churches and places, high schools, when I'm invited to speak there. And again, I think a lot of it will, some of it is reaching people one person at a time. And there are some states that offering free community college education, and I started at a community college, but I think people have to have some skin in the game, and you want to teach people how to fish rather than to feed them for a day. And so I think we have to be creative on how we reach people, but the most important thing is to realize that, you know, all minorities are not lazy, that they are not angry, that there are people just like you. That, and most people in America, I think the political parties have racialized us, one party in particular, everything is towards dividing us. But if you look at parents and you talk to most parents, they really do love their children. They want what's best for their children. And tutoring, if you're tutoring in some of the inner city schools or in various programs, I think that's a way to reach people and share your values, being a big brother or a big sister. Don't underestimate your own power and the power of words to change lives. And so everyone has the power to change lives. Everyone has the power and the ability, you know, to be all that they can be and to make that major impact in the world that we need. The worst thing you can do, though, is to go to campus and allow yourself to be intimidated, to be bullied, and to be shamed, and you don't own the responsibility for everything negative that's happened in the world. And a lot of what's taking place on the campuses, you know, it's unfair. It's unfair to everyone. And so I'm not sure if I answered your question, but that's the best I can do right now.
Thank you.
All right.
Dr. Swain, thank you very much for your time coming out to address us today. My name is Ruzzy Lane. I'm a rising senior at Hillsdale College in the state of Michigan. And recently I took a trip to Madrid, Spain with several students from your university, from Vanderbilt University. And those students, we had a conversation about you, and they said that the way you were perceived on campus, based on some of what you said about Sharia law, could be perceived to them to be offensive.
Right.
So what I'd like to know then is how you engage the discussion of Islam and of terrorism and of other issues that are related to that general area and the intersectionality therewith. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your question. Were these conservative students?
Certainly not.
Well, there are some cowardly Christians at Vanderbilt, so it could have been Christians. How many of you all know what happened to me at Vanderbilt a few years ago? Well, not many, so I'll make this as fast as I can. Yes? That was later. You almost have it, but not quite. Life as I knew it ended on January 15, 2015. It was a quiet day like any other day. and I had published an opinion piece in my local newspaper, and that wasn't unusual. I'm known for my provocative views, and so it should have been like any other opinion piece. But I criticized Islam. My bad. And this was probably, the opinion piece was written probably 7 or 8 days after the Charlie Hebdo attack in Paris. And so a lot of us, you know, we were kind of emotional. But the piece that I wrote was really to draw attention to a man in my community, Andy Miller, that had set up an organization, and he had been trying for years to really alert people to the dangers of Islam. And my opening sentence was something like, what would it take to make Americans realize that Islam was not like other religions? In fact, it posed a danger to our children and our grandchildren unless it was properly monitored. And so that was the opening sentence. And pretty much I said that because they did not believe in our Constitution, our freedom of speech and freedom of association, that it would pose a threat. And I'd never seen anything like it. It's like the world went mad, at least my little world in Nashville. And I started getting these emails. But the dean of students sent a campus-wide email to all the students, graduate and undergraduate students, offering them counseling services if they had been injured by the dangerous and radical ideas expressed in the Tennessean that day. And then one of my students sent me an email where a protest of my hatred and my bigotry was being organized. And she said, you might want to avoid campus, you know, tomorrow. And then, and so that was a protest. It got national attention. I was harassed, you know, I would say for months. Someone mailed me a 2.5-foot cardboard, you are adults, so I'm going to say penis, and told me to loosen up. And it was in the shape, it was in the shape of the object, and it had brown paper wrapping, and it had fondled with care on the outside, and it was delivered to me. No one thought it was a suspicious package. And then all the little self-righteous, just the self-righteous ones, you know, got on my social media, and, you know, and so there was a lot of harassment there. And for the first time, I started blocking people. All of a sudden, I imposed my standards of censorship. And so it was a very difficult and challenging period of my life. And that was when I first thought about leaving academia, but I did return. Now, you mentioned the petition. I was on sabbatical, thank God, when this happened. And I did actually have some fear because, in case you don't know, there are some people on the political left that are crazy. And the LGBTIAZONPRZ crowd, they joined forces with the I'm out of time. I'm sorry, I'm telling this story too slow. Bottom line is, there was a petition that had me suspended because of my insensitivity. They wanted me to go through sensitivity training. And I posted on Facebook, only an idiot would think a 61-year-old woman would benefit from, who's been in academia for, you know, umpteen years, would benefit from sensitivity training. A student responded, I must be the idiot. It was my idea. And then my Facebook friends corrected him, and then he complained that he was being terrorized. But I went back to campus, and I taught one semester, and a couple of things happened. One, I was on CNN, and I said that Black Lives Matter was a Marxist group. And I also said that I thought one reason so many young Black men were killed by police was that they resist arrest. Well, I succeeded in doing something that had never been done before in the history of the university. I united the campus. And so all of a sudden, I had blacks as well as Muslims and the LGBT crowd, you know, seeing me as a threat. But when I decided to leave academia, I decided to leave because I'm in, you know, probably the last season of my life. I want to have an impact, and I want to have access, you know, to as many young people as possible. I don't want to be tied to an institution, tied to one classroom. My classroom is the world. Thank you.
While the final selfies are being taken, I do have a list of names to call out for a photo in the back. Most of you will be individual photos, but there will be a couple group ones. So the group one, Scott Zipperly, Ethan Christopher, Kelly Heilman, Besnik Suleimani, Abby Kate Chrisman, Andrew Becker, Hannah Payne, Carolyn Lindy, Sarah Montgomery, and Tommy Beal. You're the group photo in the back. Individual photos, Ann Starkman, Hayes Law, Diego Rebular, Ashley Vaughn, Jacob Chudlinski, Victor Santos, Elaine Evers, John Wood, Matt Collarin, Lynn Cimitelli, Ellen Schutt, Gabby Aguilar, and Kathy.